long before the white man was here, or the black man, or any man except the red man, this music was there. Uncles and cousins and aunts, everybody played a mandolin, a guitar, a fiddle, or sang, or danced, or played drums, or did something. It was just, music was just a big part of their lives, and if it hadn't been for that, I probably would have never even gone into music.
The night ain't no more kicks it down.
When I was growing up in Toronto, I spent my summer vacations on the Six Nation Indian Reservation, where my mother's from. When I was 16 years old, I left Six Nations behind, and I joined up with Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks. And then the Hawks went on to become the band.
When all the bells were ringing.
Then the band joined up with Bob Dylan and eventually became something way beyond any of our wildest dreams. And somewhere along this path, I got very interested in film and ended up working with Martin Scorsese and experimenting with music and film and the effect that they had on one another. And then that affected my solo albums and what I did. I ended up kind of like scoring the songs. But it was the Native American documentary. That's what opened the little door. It gave me a valid excuse to re-educate myself. And now I'm kind of back where I started from, doing this Native music. Tools of today to do this music of Native North America that is just a piece of my growing up, a piece of my life.
Robbie has given all Native people a lot of strength because I've seen how aggressively he's gone after his history and the history of his people.
Six Nations, it all started to come together for me. I started to understand why I was doing this. A lot of it was based on things from some place deep inside that I forgot was even there.
Something I left behind. Something I nearly lost. Something I couldn't find. Someone got double crossed. Something got left.
People, you know, are going to be saying, yeah, it's terrific, you stayed in touch. Like my cousin Doug was saying, you know, oh, good to see you. What's it been, 30 years?
When you feel at home in neither.
Robbie almost, in his song, he says, I almost missed this, looking the other way.
Something I left behind, something I nearly lost, something I couldn't find, something.
know, for all of the things that I've done over the years, performances and playing all over places, there's something that's making me a little bit more nervous about coming back here and going to see this little house than any of that. They'll call me by my first name, Jamie. Little Jamie. I hope they don't call me Little Jamie anymore.
Well, the place hasn't changed too much.
How are you going, lad?
I'm okay.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you.
He first started to come up around our place when he's, I guess, maybe 2 years old or thereabouts. I can't remember exactly. Then after that, well, they came up every summer, him and his mother. He never could follow us kids around because we were in the bush. And he wasn't. But he tried.
So when did you get the TV put in?
10 years ago.
Oh, really?
Kind of modern, eh?
Yeah. What is this over? You got turkeys?
Mm-hmm.
So you've kept the outhouse...
You bet.
Very,
gotta
very
use,
well kept.
Gotta use something. Too far to walk to the bush anymore.
When I was a kid, and I would go to Six Nations, everybody played an instrument. Yeah. I mean, all my cousins, my uncles, and I thought, I gotta do this. Yeah, it's like this whole place represents music to me. And I guess it's because we didn't have anything else.
Nothing else. Every place we used to go to visit or whether there's still music there on the reservation. Any place you went out there, they usually have music.
Yeah.
Because they didn't have nothing.
Yeah.
Same as us.
Yeah. Oh, should we walk back over to the house?
He just observed, just watched. He'd just try his fingers out in here and everybody. He was just a little guy and he couldn't handle a Spanish guitar. His hands weren't big enough. But he tried.
The first time that I ever saw people play music, like right this close, where you could hear the fingers on the strings and you could hear them breathing when they were singing. And there was something about that closeness that just got to me and pushed a button in me that I never got over ever again.
I was wearing out. Fingers are getting sore.
When I was a kid, the whole native thing, it was a lot more suppressed than it is now. People from my mother's generation, and they come from a time when they were taught in school, everywhere. They were taught the Indian thing has to go. So the ceremonials, like this powwow going on now, there was little things. There was nothing this big.
The reason that I went away from the whole native background was because I thought, nobody out there gets it. Nobody cares and nobody gets it. I was definitely affected by, listen, you need to pretend this Indian thing doesn't exist. That's the way to get ahead in this world. I mean, schools taught it, parents taught it. That was their generation. Like, you have to shed this skin and just go on like Indian? What Indian? I can't let go of the pain of this. I can't let go of the old way. I can't let go of the hope. It's in your blood. I'm so caught up in trying to do right by the whole experience from my childhood. I just don't take this project and it's like another record or something and how's it doing on the charts, baby? It isn't that way. What we need to do is make a noise. We need to make a noise just to make these voices heard. These voices that have been kind of circling in the air for hundreds and hundreds of years, now to come from the air through the airwaves.
When you come over the mountain, this station comes in. It's called CKRZ from Six Nations, Ontario, Canada. It's my favorite station. You can depend on it at all times.
Welcome to CKRZ. Joining me now is Robbie Robertson.
Thank you. My favorite radio station.
Good. So welcome home again, Robbie.
Thank you so much.
It's been a complete thrill to have you come back home and to hang out on the res and cruise on the side roads and get all dusty at the powwow.
Yeah. Oh, it's a great feeling.
And we also had a chance to go and see Derek Miller, an up-and-coming musician. We did take Robbie over there while Derek was rehearsing.
You don't have another amp, do you?
Oh, you want a jam? Let me take you.
Well,
play.
Well, I just thought we could.
You play.
Well, I'll play this one.
Oh, you play that.
And I very much enjoyed running into Derek Miller, you know, this young Indian songwriter, guitar player. So this is my cousin Herb.
Herb, nice to meet you.
Derek.
Derek Miller.
So when I was a little kid, I mean, my first exposure to music was when he was playing guitar with his brother and...
So he was an early musical influence.
Yeah, I mean, this was the thing that made me say, I'm into this. The things earlier on with the band or playing with Bob Dylan, now I recognize things. Now I say, oh, that's something that my cousin Herb taught me. Or it's an Indian thing. And at the time, I thought it was a blues thing. But now I know it's an Indian thing.
For me, it's a kind of feeling of passing the baton a little bit on, you know, especially to someone from here, you know.
Yeah.
It means it's very, very close to my heart.
Just got out of the repo today.
So, this whole project, how did that come to be?
All my life, as far back as I can remember, musically, I wanted to have the opportunity to do some music with some friends of mine that I know that are great and are so talented, but because the music that they do is from the native community, a lot of the outside world doesn't know about it. So I looked at it like I could make this record, and it, for me, it would be like turning people on all over the world to some stuff that I know is really, really good and they've never heard before. It's like when you're a kid and you get a new record and you can't wait to share it with your friends. Well, it was the same thing for me. I was trying to find a way to make this work emotionally. It's a funny place between authentic Native American music and reinventing something with these people, which they're always reinventing themselves and moving on. I I don't go on the road anymore. I play live very, very rarely. But I did this concert with Lolly and Buffy Sainte-Marie, John Trudell, and the Coolidge girls. I just want to say hello to my cousin Doug over there, my first line. And I've discovered over this weekend I'm related to half of the people here on Six Nations. It was just great to see my relatives. The whole welcome back to the bush thing, it was one of the warmest feelings I've had inside that I can remember in my whole life, because some things came back to me. Musical directions that I've taken, ideas for songs, that all came from this experience.
These are the people of the Longhouse. These are the people that you tried to bring. These are the people of the Pines. Follow the code of Handsome.
In the late 1700s, there was this Seneca prophet by the name of Handsome Lake. And he became deathly ill from alcoholism.
He drank your poison, swallowed your fire, and lay with fever for long years. He received a vision.
In this vision, three of the messengers, Indian angels, came to visit him, and they said, the only way that you'll be able to get out of this disease of the spirit is to put yourself in the hands of your creator, and you will be able to help a lot of other people who have the same problem. And he began his recovery and became just an extraordinary figure as far as us going around and helping people and revealing to them there is a way out of this.
These are the people of the Pines. Follow the code of Handsome Lake. We are the people of the Longhouse. We are the people that you couldn't break.
And at that time, there were so many influences. We were being influenced by not only the alcohol, but by the ways and the lifestyles, the habits of their European brothers. They tended to start losing what kept them going for so long.
When the dark moon has come to live in your soul, get in touch with your creator. You are not alone. These are words that he had spoken 200 years ago. And today they still ring true, like they're carved in stone. When native life was hurled into the pit by way of a cannon, rum and greed, oh, a great fire was burned to let the
Six Nations, I met with Chief Jake Thomas, who every year recites the Code of Handsome Lake to this day.
It is the prophecy that people all over the world will hear the message of peace, will hear these good words that come from Handsome Lake, and there you go. We're going
the great peace, are you in?
Exactly.
I carried everything to this project. I carried melodies that I heard. I carried rhythms that I heard. I realized that if it wasn't for this experience of when I was a kid, obviously I would have never been able to even do a project like this. So I decided to record musical collaborations with all these Indian artists to go back and explore this part of my heritage. In the same way that these people have constantly adapted to change, the music changes. I also collaborated with some very talented non-native people, like Howie B. Certain people are really good at figuring out how to present this in a very musical and interesting way.
I think that Robbie's contribution to bringing Native American music into the arena of pop music is part of his magic, of being able to record with modern technology and to bring all of these other elements. He's bringing it to today because we've had to hide so much of our culture for so long.
About this idea of hearing this old, beautiful chant that is fading away, and this aggressive attitude of trying to keep it above water. Has evolved. We're not doing anything that hasn't been going on for a long, long time. And the only way you know whether something's really working is in the collaboration of it.
Spirit, bring DNA. Descendant.
That's nice.
Ancestor. We are the spirit of the ancient ones. Robbie gave you some music. Took me into the music, right? And then I was told a story. And then we'll see what kind of a song the story is.
What these days have seen. Spirit hunter, always hunting. The great lie, wounding, killing imagination. Defend yourself. Defend yourself. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. All our relations. All living things. The stone people say, paint yourself into the dream. DNA. descendant, ancestor.
We're the descendants of tribes. Just, you know, there's that genetics working, the DNA, just that connection, that spiritual link to the past and the future. Even if we can't coherently and consciously really understand that link, we still have it.
Spirit being into the dream. Paint yourself.
So we're the interpreter generation. We can communicate about our genetic memories, which has not been erased from us yet.
The stone people say,
studio in Santa Fe was just a place that everybody could get to. I wanted to be in the heart of Indian country, and there's still lots of places you can go, and they're just the same way as they were 1,000 years ago. There are so many different kinds of Native music. I could spend years just in that area exploring all kinds of different possibilities. Very much wanted to work with some peyote singers. These two guys, Primo and Mike, have a particular sound that is so beautiful, so spiritual sounding to me. I really wanted to experiment some music together.
I'm looking for salvation, Father. Help me. You know, with sincerity, aid me in my quest for salvation. There was a time when our people, they had to hide out in the hills just to sing these songs, use the peyote, you know. It was considered a narcotic, you know. People try to use it, have their ceremonies. They used to get thrown in prison, jail.
When they take the medicine, it gives them the opportunity to get a complete connection to your higher power.
There is a life to this music. All these songs to us, you know, they're prayers. They say this peyote, these songs, you know, it's just a little bit of what God is, you know.
four, five, 6, and 7 years old, my dad was a peyote man. He'll have his arm out, and I'll be laying in his arm, and he's got his rattle. And I learned them songs. Uh-huh. I was the right age.
You know, a lot of the music that we're talking about started to appear at the turn of the century, when the Kiowas, the Comanche, and the Apaches were being, in the words of the government, civilized. And the missionaries introduced Christian hymns into our people. Because our people are so involved in music, they were able to compose those songs into their own language.
You know, I mean, it's, you can tell that they're hymns, but there's something that happens to these hymns when they're sung and not only translated lyrically, but translated musically into native tongue.
The whole education experience for our Indian people since the turn of the century, 1900, has been an education for extinction by putting the children in boarding schools so far away from their homes, they would cut off their hair, they would prohibit them from speaking their tribal language and punish them if they had anything to do with their cultural ceremonies.
And then within our lifetime, we were renamed Native Americans. And see, I don't really think that's who we are. I know that's not who we are. We're the people. We are the descendants of the ancients or the ancestors.
Pray with me.
The ancient songs, when we use them now, you know, we're using ancient songs to sing to the about to become extinct. Well, I mean, if we want to get right down into this, that's what's going on here.
The native people lived alongside of the buffalo. The buffalo and them were so much a part of one another. Went from being 40 million buffalo to being less than 500 in 100 years. The same thing was happening to the people that was happening to the buffalo.
Crows brought the message to the children of the sun for the return of the buffalo and for a better day to come.
Wovaka was a southern Ute from Ignacio, Colorado, and he started the ghost dance to bring back the buffalo.
Ghost dance is one of the most extraordinary stories in Native American history, I think. This was a way for Native Americans to worship, which is the same way as going to church for other people. When the government heard about this, this is like in 1860, they said, there's something about this we don't like. Ghost dance, don't even like the name.
the outlaw, the ghost dance. We shall live again.
Non-Indian people in the Calvary felt that this new dance was drumming up some kind of retaliatory effort to get back at them.
When they told them you have to stop this, it was like, what? What do you mean we have to stop this? I mean, we are praying for the return of the buffalo and for a better day to come.
We shall live again.
Unfortunately, the Sioux Nation took the beating in this. There was 300, mostly women and children, that were massacred. Unarmed people at Wounded Knee. This is the story of Wounded Knee.
My sister alone. She has red paint. She died at Wounded Knee. Like a Latter-day
Saint. Wonka said that our medicine is not going to help against the white man. They're beginning to be as leaves on the trees. So I regret to say that this is the end of our way of life.
Come on, Comanche.
I think it's that the music that Robbie is doing communicates, because they're story songs. They have a lot of modern sounds, but at the same time, there's the contrast of the story that's being told and the lies that are being exposed, because the stories have not been told truthfully. And if we can do it through our music, then that's the way to do it.
Then, in the 70s, 100 years later, in the same place in Wounded Knee, there was this standoff between AIM, the American Indian Movement, and the FBI. Buffy Sainte-Marie wrote a song, Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee, which completely describes, you know, what happened.
Bury my heart.
In 1973, the American Indian Movement occupied Wounded Knee in Pine Ridge, South Dakota. And this again was over treaty, and the government made certain promises as to what they would do, so then the occupation ended. But between that time of May of 1973 and June of 1975, there were close to 60 or 70 violent deaths on the Pine Ridge Reservation. In June of 1975, there was a firefight in Oglala at the Jumping Bull land. And involved in this firefight were agents of the FBI and members of the American Indian Movement. The result of the firefight is two FBI agents and one Indian man were dead.
That was the whole thing that Leonard Peltier went down for. It's just a classic case of injustice. And we all know that in Indian country, this is a strong possibility. And Leonard, unfortunately, has been a scapegoat in this whole Wounded Knee situation.
Sacrifice your freedom. Sacrifice your prayer. Take away your language. Cut off all your hair.
Hi, Leonard.
I was in the middle of making this record, and one day he called me on the phone and he was talking to me, and I thought, everybody else has described Leonard Peltier's situation, but nobody's ever heard him speak on his own behalf to tell the story himself.
My name is Leonard Peltier. I am a Lakota and Anishinaabe. And I'm living in the United States Penitentiary, which is the swiftest growing Indian reservations in the country. I've been in prison since 1976 for an incident that took place on the Ogallala Lakota Nation. There was a shootout between members of the American Indian Movement and the FBI and the local sheriffs, state troopers. Two agents were killed, and one Indian was murdered. Three of us were charged with the deaths of the FBI agents. Co-defendants were found not guilty by reasons of self-defense. My case was separated and I was found guilty before a jury of non-Indian people. The prosecutor stated that they did not know who killed their agents, nor did he know what participation Leonard Peltier may have played in it. But someone has to pay for the crime.
When we did that, we put the voice with this music and everything. It was just like, oh my God, this is something that to feel Leonard Peltier's situation, not the information, but to feel it. I can't think of a stronger way to do it.
There's a lot of nights that I lay in my cell and can't understand why this hell and this terror that I've been going through for 21 years hasn't ended.
Some kind of an ancient rite of some sort, the sacrifice that you make. And he survives by getting good out of the sacrifice. I mean, how else can he survive?
I'm guilty of standing up for my people's rights. I'm guilty of trying to stop the oppression that I've experienced and I've seen my people experience.
I've gone too far now to start backing down. I don't give up. Not until my people are free will I give up. And if I have to sacrifice some more, then I sacrifice some more.
Our crime is being Indian.
America as a concept does not want to recognize us still.
He says he does not have your horses.
He's a liar.
You're right, Clark. The only Indian that don't lie is a dead one.
All of the imagery that is put out about us, whether it's in the written word or the visual or the... It wants to lock us into this romanticist past of 100 years ago.
Hey, red boy, where you going with that drum? Are you gonna play a swan? Hey, hey, red boy, where you going with that gun? Are you gonna wax home? Where you going with that pain on your face?
Music is ancient, contemporary, and futuristic. Music just is. What changes is the instruments that the music comes through and the perceptions and attitudes of people. But music is a constant.
We have come.
In this world, that's right, you bet your ass we won't go quietly. And I think the more Native voices I hear singing that song, that means that the pride has come back into our people.
Native people have been silent for so long, it's a good time to be in your face.
Make it a noise.
Upbringing is to take the best of both worlds. In my family, we live in our traditional values, but yet we live in a new world too. So what I did was just take our values and combine them with the modern ways, and it's just a perfect blend.
So happy to be here. It's just, this weekend has just been one of the best moments of my whole life, and I've been out there pushing the envelope for a lot of years and everything. I got quite a few things to compare it to, and this is as good as it gets for me.
Yes, sir. Well, when you're out here and you're under the stars, what better place in this world is better than this?
So welcome back to the bush.
Welcome back to the bush, yeah.
Welcome back to the bush.
Here's to the bush.
Hey, young way ho way,
young way ho way, young way ho way, young way ho way.
Way, hey, ya, way, ya, hey, ya,
way, ya, hey, ya, way, ya, hey, ya, way, ya, hey, ya.
Really, the evolution of this project is of just starting with this little spark and some ideas and some experimenting, and it just growing and growing and growing.
We all went off on our own ways and had our own experiences, but whatever Robbie learned or I learned or anyone learns, when our genetic memory kicks into place, there is a purpose. We had all these experiences. It's like making this big painting, you know, and you paint in the background and then you start painting in the figures and it all starts to add up. And that's what this project really is all these pieces and all these people coming together and all these dreams.
This program has been made possible in part by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting through Native American Public Telecommunications.
This is PBS.
So I didn't get a chance to meet you formally.
Well, how you doing? This is, I'm Arnie General.
You're Chief Arnie. Yeah. Now listen, we've got to talk about the car thing, Arnie.
What about the car? It runs good.
No, that's the coolest car I've ever seen. All right.
Show me one of those, like, G chord.
Okay.
Wow, look at there, big G. Those chords up there scared me.
Yeah. Great to see you.
40 more years?
Yeah.
I'll be here. I'll try to stick around.
Okay. All right, promise.
Get your mother.
Nice to see you. Yeah, I will.
I want to see your mom.
I'm going to tell her that.
Before I'm gone.
She'll really appreciate that,
sir. Or she's gone.
Yeah.
Her.
Okay. All right. Okay, we're going to go over to the powwow then and get into a little trouble over there.
Well, try to.